won't apologize for whether or not this turns out to be a haphazard presentation, because I pulled slides from a lot of different places that we have slides, and some of them are kind of technical and some of them kind of aren't, right? So I don't know, we'll just kind of see how it goes. But Onur is here, he's manager of our advanced device technologies. So, you know, whenever a customer or a grant proposal needs some crazy ass new thing, Onur's the tip of the spear on that. So afterwards, I mean, if we hang around for a few minutes, he's also a Stanford PhD and came out about the same time as me, right? I mean, so the company that myself and Homan Yuen and Vijit Savnis, two other PhDs here, started in 2007, is called Solar Junction. And we make multi-junction 3-5 material-based solar cells for two applications. One of them for terrestrial-based concentrators, and I'll talk a little bit about what that is. And this class of technology also powers basically all the space satellites that we fly as the human race, you know, today. So we're trying to break into that market. It's a, you know, takes a long time to fly billion-dollar satellites because they want a lot of credibility. But one day we will have it. So let's see. So let's just get started. So where do we fit? You know, there's all these different types of solar. Let's see if I can get this to run here. And you got your nice flat plate here, and you got nano solar and thin film and whatnot over here, and you've got solar thermal, where you heat up basically a fluid in these tubes. And then you've got concentrating photovoltaics, and this is where we play over here. And if you look at what that is, basically it's all the same idea. You take some kind of a concentrating element, and the light shines through this and focuses down to a very small cell. And concentrations today in our customer systems are around the 1,000x to 1,500x level. So it's a very high concentration kind of system. And you basically concentrate, you're basically imaging the sun almost, although it's non-imaging optics and whatnot, but you're kind of like imaging the sun down onto the chip with a giant magnification. And there are many different companies around the world that are pursuing a variety of different approaches of implementing some kind of concentrating element shining down onto a cell. And so you've got, you know, giant dishes that focus onto a central receiver array, and you've got, you know, mirrors that focus down onto a single cell, or you've got Fresnel lenses, kind of Fresnel lens approach over here. You know, you just take a sheet of plastic and stamp a Fresnel lens and focus the light down onto a cell. So there's a whole variety of different different companies out there. We do the solar cells. We don't do the rest of the systems. Our customers do those systems. Now, because you need to essentially image the sun down onto the cell, our technology is applicable in this region here and in Australia and South Africa. So places, it's not very good for Maine. There isn't enough sun there. You want uncloudy days, because you really want to capture all the direct normal light and focus it down onto the cell. So cloudy days aren't so good, so you're really looking at, you know, North Africa and the Southwest and Mexico and a variety of places. So to kind of recap here, what happens is, in concentrated PV, you focus the light down onto the cell. We make the cells. We also package those cells. Right now we're on a triple junction cell format, so we've got three junctions. We'll talk a little bit about that. Our technology platform and roadmap allows us to add more junctions and continue to improve efficiency. And our target over the next few years is to get on up to 50%. We have a materials breakthrough that really allows us to blow past the previous kind of device paradigm in this area and get well above 40%, which we're doing. Our 44% is a world record. It's been measured at NREL. It's a certifying agency. Our previous world record was measured at both Fraunhofer and NREL at 43.5%. And we're enabling customers to make, you know, capture more than a third of the sunlight at a module level. So after you account for system losses and whatnot, you know, a 40% cell turns into a mid-30s percent module. These are the highest conversion efficiencies for PV that I'm aware of, and certainly at the cell level, we hold that record there. In CPV, basically, the cell efficiency matters a lot because the cell is a relatively small portion of the overall system cost. So if you can improve cell efficiency, you don't have to deploy as many panels, and it saves you a whole lot of money. So unlike some other forms of solar where it's all about getting the cost out of the solar cell, in our technology set, you can, because of the concentration, you can actually pay for pouring more technology into the solar cell, provided it gives you the efficiency benefit, which offsets other costs elsewhere in the system. And as a company, we've really grown. We've proven out the technology. Our market is growing. Our customers want our product. We have a pilot line in San Jose. We do everything. So bare wafers come in and product goes out the door. We've been sold out for 2012. We've signed up a manufacturing partner in IQE. They're an international epi deposition company. They're handling our epi deposition expansion. We have a program from the Department of Energy to expand our wafer fab, which we're doing in Sunnyvale. So we have a second building now with a 6-inch fab over there. So, you know, the arc of our company has been pretty awesome, really. We started in an executive office with just a few people and a dream, and now we have two buildings and 70,000 square feet or some god-awful thing, and you know, a couple of fabs, and we're off to the races. And as I said before, our core technology is good for CPV, but it can also power space satellites, and we're looking at that market. So company history, just briefly, we were founded in 2007, and we have these two buildings here. You know, we've got a fab. We're about 50 people. And right now, we do bare substrates in, and solar cell product comes out of our buildings. It hasn't been boring. I'll tell you, startup life is full of ups and downs. If you ever think about doing it, you will feel awesome on some days. You'll be like, oh, how can this possibly fail? And then on other days, you're going to be like, how could I possibly have been so stupid as to spend any of my effort on this thing? This is never going to work, or it's going to die, or any number of things. So, you know, going through all those phases, you kind of learn to get a steady hand at the ups and downs, because there are ups and downs. So here's the chart. So the chart is up here. You know, we're up there. We hold the previous two world records, and our competitors, you know, took us up to this point, and we've kind of, we like to think we've kind of taken over from here, guys. Thanks for all the hard work, but we've got it now. And we'll talk about how we get up here into these efficiency numbers. So there you go. Okay, so a little bit about how we do all of that. A bit about 3-5 multi-junction cells. So we're all familiar with the sun. It puts out light. Black body kind of radiation, more or less. And this is the spectrum that you see if you're out in space. But once you come down through the atmosphere, you've got all this absorption in the atmosphere, so you've got these absorption lines and whatnot. So the spectrum that you're really capturing is either the red or the green spectrum, and different times of the year and when the sun's in different parts of the horizon, you know, this spectrum can actually change significantly. So this is the standard that we all design against. But if you're designing a device where the spectral content of the light matters, you got to pay attention to how that spectrum changes. So keep that in mind as we go through this. So one of the major losses in solar cells is a thermalization loss. If a photon in this very broad spectrum from the sun comes in at the same band gap as the material that's absorbing it, you know, you create an electron in a hole, and they're basically sitting at the conduction and the valence band, and everything's happening. You haven't lost a whole lot of energy. You collect, say, a blue photon, and you create this electron and hole pair way up here, and they rattle down to the conduction and valence band, and you lose some amount of energy. And this is one of the things that we're able to battle in multi-junction solar cells. So if I again look at the solar spectrum here, and I look at silicon absorbs this yellow part of the spectrum, and the rest of the infrared passes on through. So if I look at the energy conversion efficiency of a photon at any one of these wavelengths here, right around the band gap, really high energy conversion ratio. But out here in the blue, you're not going to be converting the energy in that photon nearly as efficiently. In multi-junction solar cells, what we do is we break up the light into different junctions. Hey, look at that. And the blue is absorbed on top, the red is absorbed on bottom. And what this allows us to do is it allows us to beat the thermalization loss, at least sort of, right? Now, there are a whole bunch of other losses in any of these systems, but this is the main bit that gets you to higher efficiencies. Now, what do these cells look like? Well, they look something like that. This is obviously larger than life. You know, this might be a millimeter on a side, and we build them on wafers. So here's a 4-inch wafer with a bunch of solar cells on them, and if you forward bias them, they all light up because they're basically LEDs, and we just use them in reverse. And the stack might look something like this. This is more of a competitor stack. I'll get into what our stack looks like, but you know, it's lot of different layers in this thing. It's kind of complicated. You've got a top cell, you've got a tunnel diode that connects the top cell, top p-n junction, and the middle p-n junction, another tunnel diode connecting the bottom p-n junction. You've got front surface fields and back surface fields, and you've got graded doping in emitters and bases to reduce losses. And so there's a whole lot of optimization and engineering of the material stack and the materials properties that goes into making good solar cells. But what you can ultimately think about is you can think about a circuit model that looks like this. You've basically got three diodes, and each of these diodes is connected by a tunnel junction. And the thing to remember here is what I write right here, that the subcell with the lowest current is going to limit the overall current out of this entire device. Right, so let's just keep that in mind. So if we go back to this idea of splitting up the spectrum into different junctions, you're going to want to create a simulator or something that says, gee, if I were to create these three band gaps and absorb light in these three chunks, how much current is that going to generate in each of the three subcells? And am I current matched or misbalanced? How do I optimize this triple junction absorber? And if you look at what people have done, not solar junction, but others to date, is they've done a materials platform very much like this. You've got an in-gap solar cell with a band gap about here, basically a gallium arsenide solar cell with a band gap here, and then they use germanium. And if you look at what the reason they do that is because all of those materials are all going to be lattice matched. So you can take a germanium substrate and you can grow gallium arsenide on it, you can grow in-gap on it, everything's lattice matched, everybody's happy, all the atoms line up. So that's great. Here are the band gaps here for those three materials. But you go and you do your spectral analysis and your current analysis, and you find that the top cell generates about 14 milliamps per centimeter squared at one sun. Middle is 14. The bottom germanium cell produces a whole lot of extra current. So you're absorbing a bunch of photons, and you're generating a potential current, but you're not actually harvesting any energy out of all of that. So there's something non-optimal about this way of slicing up the spectrum. Now, you could try moving the band gaps of the top two around and rebalancing to maybe around 15 to 16 milliamps in each of the three junctions. You could do that, and you can think about doing that. But the problem, of course, is what materials are you going to use to do that? You can still use germanium down here. You can still find a gallium arsenide-based lattice-matched material here. But there's no material in this middle region to give you that band gap. And so what some of our competitors have done to break past the core node of a germanium-based triple junction is they've gone to non-lattice match growth. So what they've done is, you know, if this is one crystal lattice, this is another crystal lattice, they basically said, hey, we don't need to match. We'll just grow crappy material. And that doesn't really work for solar cells. It's a very hard problem. If we could easily grow lattice mismatched 3-5 base materials, we'd grow them all on silicon, and you know, things would be very different. You'd all be studying that. Some of you are, but it would be mainstream, right? So that's a very challenging class of problems. So you really need some new materials in order to pull off re-engineered band gaps in this kind of a multi-junction paradigm. You need a material where you can tune the band gap and maintain the lattice constant. So that you can always, so whatever the optimal triple junction device is for a certain spectrum, well, you can build that. When you go to four junctions, you can ask your computer, what are the optimal four slices of the spectrum? Gives you four band gaps, you can build that. That's what you want. So another way of rebalancing these currents is to keep the top two cells exactly the same, gallium arsenide based cell and an in-gap based cell. But instead of using germanium, which has a band gap down out here, you know, can you find another material that has a much higher band gap that gives you kind of a current matched accuracy, re-optimize the device? And if you look, let's see if this is animated. Hey, look at that. It is. If you look around here at 1EV, right, there really isn't a lattice matched material that sits here. So you'd have to go non-lattice matched. And we do see competitors out there who are trying to do this. So they try to grow these materials with these big, huge step-graded buffers to grade the lattice constant from gallium arsenide to something else that they can get 1EV out of. And again, that's a very challenging kind of problem. So our solution at Solar Junction is to use a dilute nitride material system, which many of you probably know was developed in Japan, well, maybe you don't know this part, it was kind of invented in Japan, and it came here, and then Jim Harris got a hold of it, and people in his group worked on it for a good decade or so. And we took that and perfected it even further. So what we do is we grow our 1EV bottom cell with a dilute nitride material, which maintains lattice matching across all of these cells. And the way we do that is if you took gallium arsenide and you added indium down to indium arsenide, you go this way with lattice constant. Turns out if you add nitrogen, you have this big Boeing parameter. So you can add nitrogen and reduce the band gap. And hey, if you just balance them just right, here's what you can do. You can maintain lattice constant with gas, with gallium arsenide, but you have access to a wide range of band gaps here. So when I use existing materials that are lattice matched to gas, which give me access to these band gaps up here, and I add to that the dilute nitride material, I basically have a suite of materials that I can use to put a band gap anywhere I'd like in the relevant solar spectrum, anywhere I'd like. And they'll all be lattice matched. So now when you do a, when you, you know, try to optimize your triple junction cell, you can put band gaps wherever you like. When we go to four junctions, we'll ask our computer, you know, computer, what are the best four band gaps you can use? We'll actually be able to build that device, five junctions and so on. So all of a sudden you've opened up a technology roadmap that allows you to go from where we were, where our competitors were limited just below 40%, now on up to 44, which is maxing out what is basically possible in a triple junction cell. And then we'll be able to go to four junctions and five junctions and even six junctions and continue to push the efficiency ever higher. So kind of here's, you know, here's our pitch for lattice matching and you know, against lattice matching. You don't like defects. Okay, so in a nutshell, that's that.